agenda, we will get a clearer picture of the government's position.
Government bills. This council resumes the second reading debate on the Family Procedure Bill. Mr. Holden Chow, chairman of the Bills Committee on the Bill, will first address the council on the committee's report. Mr. Holden Chow. Mr. President, in the capacity of the Chairman of the Bills Committee on Family Procedure Bill, I now submit the report on our deliberation. The bill seeks to introduce a new single piece of primary legislation, which provides the legal basis to consolidate the various procedural rules of the family justice system scattered over different ordinances. The Bills Committee has held four meetings, including one attended by deputations from the public. Members generally support the bill, which will consolidate the various procedural rules of the family justice system scattered over different ordinances, hoping that the currently complicated court-related procedures for family and matrimonial matters could be simplified and streamlined. In the course of scrutiny, members raised concerns over a number of policy matters and the contents of the bill. First, members were concerned how the bill would benefit family court users in terms of time and cost saved on procedural issues, and how it would facilitate the enforcement of the family court orders concerning cross-border marriages in the mainland. Members and deputations in particular hoped that the bill would assist those maintenance payees having difficulties in collecting the maintenance payments and enforcing the maintenance orders. In response, the Judiciary Administration said that the main purpose of the bill is to give effect to procedural reforms for the family justice system. There is no intention to introduce any changes to the substantive policy under the purview of policy bureaus. Members generally welcomed the proposal to set up a new family masters system to alleviate the workload of family judges. On the other hand, members were highly concerned about the composition of the Family Procedure Rules Committee, or the FPRC. Some members suggested that stakeholders who are not legal professionals, including those from the social welfare sector, should be invited to the FPRC so that views from other stakeholders would be considered at an early stage. Section 154(1) of the schedule proposes amendments to paragraph B of the definition of child under section 2(1) of the Inheritance Provision for Family and Dependence Ordinance Cap 481. It involves the issue of inheritance by a child who was in the womb of his or her mother. There was an in-depth discussion on the topic, and the judiciary was requested to provide supplementary information on the rationale behind the proposed amendments. Besides the above, members and the legal advisor of the Bills Committee have raised concerns over a number of policy issues and drafting matters. On these concerns, as well as submissions from the public, the judiciary has given either oral or written replies. We support the amendments to be moved by the administration. No amendments will be moved by the Bills Committee. The Bills Committee has completed its work. The details of our deliberation are set out on the report to the Council. President, the followings are my views on the bill. President, as mentioned in my report, the Family Procedure Bill seeks to harmonize court-related procedures in relation to family and matrimonial matters scattered across different legislation so that the procedure can be streamlined on family matters. Now, these are rather technical changes. However, subsequent to the legislative amendment exercise, there will be a Family Procedure Rules Committee, or the FPRC. Subject to the passage of the bill, the FPRC will be empowered to set procedural rules on family cases. Now, it will affect court users and also parties in family proceedings. So members of the Bills Committee took the opportunity to put forward important views to the administration, including that in past family proceedings, there were a lot of issues or difficulties on recovering or collecting maintenance payments. Now, in the recovery process, unbearable pain was caused to the payees. When the party has to collect maintenance from the default party, the rifts between the two parties would be widened. Now, we have spoken a lot on this during the deliberation. After divorce, the relationship has deteriorated. And in the process of recovery of maintenance, the parties have to confront each other. Disputes would be caused and the children would be the one to suffer. So in that process, unbearable pain would be dealt to both parties. That's why I said that. Now, to resolve this issue, we think it might be best for the government to establish a maintenance board. This independent body would handle the maintenance recovery process that would minimize the occurrence of the situation I mentioned, that is, parties coming into conflicts in the recovery process. And in the past, there were cases where new causes derived from the recovery process. Now, it would add to the time and cost in court. So that would be an unbearable pain to grassroots people. If we have this independent maintenance board for recovery of maintenance, we can alleviate this problem as well as reduce the burden on the judiciary. And some members also suggested that in setting the family procedure rules, the FPRC should canvass views from the general public and court users so that the final product is user-friendly and simple to understand. So these are our views. Now, we understand that besides this FPRC, there is also a committee to consult court users under the judiciary. Now, if the judiciary can consult the general public, the court users, as well as professionals in the social welfare sector more, it would be best. Now, maybe subgroup can be established under the FPRC involving these stakeholders. That would be very important. Now, in the deliberation process, we also queried whether there should be a more well-equipped front desk under the family court. Now, the small claims tribunal has such an organ to answer queries made by the general public on claims. Now, if the family court has this organ, then the burden on the family court and family judges would be reduced. And we can also resort to technologies like AI in helping court users. Now, there are lots of complaints from the parties to family processes. They think the legal jargons are very difficult to understand. So if there are some tools to help them understand the general procedures and what they can expect, the user's experience would be improved. So riding on the opportunity, this committee has put forward the above views. And we hope that the government would take on board their views and follow up on the matters appropriately. Thank you.
Dr. Elizabeth Kwart, thank you, President. Hong Kong's divorce rate is very high. In recent years, has climbed. According to the CNSD department, in 2019, the divorce rate is 48%. And in 2020, the figure has climbed to over 50%. Every year, there are around 20,000 divorce cases. I come from a single-parent family, and I've experienced myself how drastic changes in the family have caused pain to not only the divorcees, the parents, but also to the children. The children will feel helpless. So we have the family court. The original intent was to help divorcing families to resolve their problems, to help them tide over their difficulties during a divorce. So for the family procedure bill, I support it. The bill's object is very clear, and that is to streamline the rules and procedures. And hopefully, after the procedures have been streamlined, proceedings related to matrimony and family matters can be made simpler, and it can help a lot of people. I'm particularly concerned about establishing an FPRC Family Procedure Rules Committee, which will formulate new family procedure rules, FPR. At the Bills Committee, President, we have spoken about views from families. And here, I would like to speak about the FPR. And hopefully, the rules can improve on procedures and measures to help more people, especially when a family has completed the first litigation and maintenance is granted to a party. But then if the other party refuses to pay maintenance, the divorced husband and wife, what he or she can do? According to the present laws, the payee can be mandated to pay the payer can be mandated to pay the maintenance, summons can be issued, deductions can be made to the person's salary. But then I have received views from a lot of single mothers who complained to us. They said that these orders cannot be implemented for the most part. What are the reasons? Say, for example, if a summons is issued, if the payer refuses to pay, you can prosecute him or her again. But the fact is that you have to serve a summons on him first. If you fail to do so, you will not be able to reach him. Then there is no way that the order can be executed. And somebody may stand in the way of you accessing the party. So if there is a default in payment for over 12 months, the court may refuse to execute the maintenance order. And there have been cases where the summons cannot be served. And 12 months have passed, and the court judge said that since you can't fend for your means, fend for your life during those 12 months, that means you don't need it. And as a result, the ruling is that the maintenance doesn't have to be paid. Isn't that very ridiculous? This is a real case. And a lot of people face that kind of difficulty, and the situation must be improved. And then you will issue a new maintenance order. You have to reach the person concerned. But very often, you may fail to reach him. If there is a divorce and you can't reach the other party, you can take out an advertisement in the newspapers to make a notification to him or her. But then for the maintenance order, you have to serve the order in person to the other party before the order can be executed. So that presents a problem. If the payer refuses to pay, then you can have his wage deducted. That is an order for them. But then there is another problem. You have to access the employer of the spouse, and you have to serve the order to the employer. And you ask the employer to deduct the salary and pay you the maintenance. But very often you fail to reach or find the employer. Even if you have found the employer, the bailiff has found him, but then the the person fails to admit that he is a party to the proceeding, and the bailiff cannot check his identity. So as a result, the order fails to be served. So there are a number of loopholes. And then even if you have managed to find the employer and the party is worried, and then he pays, but then he only pays part of the maintenance fee, say $1,000 instead of $10,000, and he has to be appearing in the court, and he refuses to do so. And as a result, the family doesn't have an income, say in half a year or a year. There are also very unconscionable parties. Before the person appears in court, he will resign, and he is unemployed. And he can tell the judge that since he doesn't have an income, then he is allowed not to pay. And then you can issue an order prohibiting him or her to leave Hong Kong. Some of them have fled to outside of Hong Kong and the mainland. So can you take the person to task when he is in the mainland? No, you can't do so. So all these are problems. Even if the rules have been amended, can they really help these divorced families? Now, if they fail to get the maintenance, they will apply for CSSA. But then the court has ruled that she is entitled to maintenance, so she can't get CSSA. And then if she has to apply for CSSA, she has to present proof that she fails to receive a maintenance. And if that is the case, she has to ask the ex-husband to appear in court. And so as a result, she fails to apply for CSSA. How can she support her days and her living? So what is happening here? As a result, many people have decided, even though that she is entitled to maintenance, she thinks that the other party will not pay, so she is asking just for $1 and then apply for CSSA. Well, at least she gets a certain amount and can support her children and her daily needs. And the Single Parent Family Association made a telephone survey, and some 100 families have been interviewed. 90% have directly applied for CSSA instead of getting payments because they know that they will not be able to collect the maintenance. So CSSA comes from the public cover. Should we be using the public cover to help these irresponsible people? How much are we spending annually on that front? And these families should be entitled to maintenance, but then they are now being supported on CSSA. So the government must come up with a figure on that front. And we've been hoping that the government can establish a maintenance board or a special body under the IRD to do work on that front. We must protect the divorced family and also the children therein. You can imagine that suddenly the income of a family is gone, and the child will feel very helpless. He can't afford extracurricular activities, the textbooks. Well, this is my personal experience. I couldn't join any extracurricular activities for lack of means. So you must help these families, help them fend for themselves. There are different mandatory measures adopted in other places. Say the accounts of the parties to the accounts of the maintenance payers have been frozen and so on. There are many different measures that you can adopt. The government has said that it will not set up the maintenance board. Say that the number of families in need of maintenance is only in thousands, so there is no need for the maintenance board. But then every year there are some 20,000 people. Families getting a divorce, but then tens of thousands of families are facing difficulties in getting maintenance payments. They couldn't get help from you. So if there is a maintenance board to help them, it can alleviate the workload of the courts. It can also cut down on the expenditure coming from the CSSA program to help these families. I hope that through this legislative exercise, we can tell the administration that you cannot help the divorced families by just amending the rules. There are so many other things you can do. Mr. Ambrose Lam, well, it's something painful for a family to get, for a couple to get a divorce. Now, after the divorce, issues relating to maintenance, custody of children are involved. These are problems that will linger on. Dr. Kwok has cited a number of cases. I will not repeat them here. For divorced couples, if they cannot resolve problems related to their finances and children in an amicable manner, then they have to resort to the legal proceedings, which are very complicated. And this is a kind of torture mentally for the couple and also the children. The cumbersome procedures mean that the couple will fight against each other, and that will seriously damage the children's growth. And one of the reasons is that the procedures are now dispersed among a number of ordinances, subsidiary legislation, and practice direction. And parties to the proceedings have to spend a lot of time to deal with the complicated procedures. In some of the ordinances, French expressions even not comprehensible, even to the French, are still being used. So we are discussing the Family Procedure Bill today, that is to help the divorced couples try to streamline the complicated legal proceedings, shorten the procedures so that these legal provisions can be made clearer and simpler. The bill seeks to simplify the family proceedings, setting out the jurisdiction of the High Court and the Family Court and their powers, and also terms will be simplified. Plain language will be used to cut down on the number of disputes. Our lawyers have to explain to their clients the complicated rules. This is very, this is not good. Well, people are already unhappy in a divorce, and they even are forced to pay heed to such complicated terms. That's very bad. So we support the bill. We hope that the family proceedings can be expedited and help the divorced families resolve issues so they can lead a new life again. Now, this bill is a broad framework, and later on, a FPRC will be set up and rules will be devised to regulate and specify the legal family proceedings and procedures of the High Court and the Family Court. The Bills Committee has scrutinized the bill. We have arranged a public hearing to listen to the public's views. I would like to I also took this opportunity to invite many family law experts to submit written submissions to the LegCo, or even came to the LegCo to share their valuable views. And some of their views have got positive response from the administration. I would like to thank them for expanding their time and their valuable views. They have contributed a lot to the legislative exercise. We hope that through improving the family laws in Hong Kong, more people facing divorce, including the spouses and the children, can go through the process more smoothly. Let me remind that this exercise is just part of the entire family amendment legislative exercise. We must work on other fronts. We have to work on a bill to set out the responsibilities of the parents and also other aspects. This will help families, and this may possibly attract the rich to come to Hong Kong to stay here and set up family offices and deal with their families' properties in Hong Kong. This can help attract investment for overseas and help with driving the development of Hong Kong. I hope that the current term government can expedite the work so that the family procedures can be improved as soon as possible.
Dr. Teck Chee Yun, Madam Deputy, society situation is very complicated, and every year we have more and more divorcees. There are more people getting divorced than people getting married each year. So if there are sufficient safeguards under the legislation to save, to protect families when they run into problems, I would fully support it. So today I speak in support of the Family Procedure Bill. Now this is only the first step. We are just establishing a legal framework specifying what's to come in terms of family procedure improvements, so that members of the public can understand these procedures more easily. Now, the relevant procedural matters are very foreign to grassroots people, and it deprives them of the legal safeguard that they should, that they are entitled to. So this is only the first step. The crux of the issue is how we can further enhance the relevance law in the future so that more people can better understand the legal procedures. Now, I welcome the administration promise that the relevance enhancement exercise will be completed within 2 years. I welcome the government's determination on this. Now, we are concerned about the upcoming legislative amendments to be conducted, as mentioned by Mr. Ambrose Lam. That is where the most important things lie. Now, the more importantly, we will have the FPRC established after the passage of the bill. So I have suggested whether we can include experienced professionals or stakeholders other than legal professionals. They should also be allowed to join the FPRC so that there is a diversified scope of fields in the committee. Now, the administration told me that most of the issues to be considered by the FPRC are technical matters, so it would be more appropriate that legal professionals form the majority of the FPRC. But there are also positive responses from the government. The government would consider inviting professional investigators in the committee. Now, the government said that many legal professionals have experience and expertise in mediation. So mediators' roles can also be played by the legal professionals in the committee. Now, we welcome this. Besides the legal procedures, mediation is also helpful. Now, if we can include the elements of mediation in the future system, it will be much more beneficial to the users. Now, I also hope that the FPRC will involve other stakeholders like social workers or even professionals in the education sector. They are experienced in handling family matters and they have very acute observations. Now, it is most important for the FPRC to canvass these views as well at an early stage. Now, the administration has promised that the FPRC would actively consult these stakeholders before formulation of the rules. Now, rather than comprising members other than legal professionals in the committee, the administration would canvass their views before the formulation of rules. Now, I think it is acceptable. Now, I agree with the chairman's, Mr. Holden Chow's suggestion that maybe we can set up subgroups under the FPRC to incorporate more stakeholders. I think the government may consider this. Now, upon this legislative exercise, we hope that the government can keep its promises, that is, to complete the relevant legislative amendments within 2 years, and two, canvass public views widely, so that the final product meets the needs of the public better. Thank you. Mr. Tang Fei, Madam Deputy, I speak in support of the legislative amendments to the Family Procedure Ordinance, family procedures in the legislation. Now, it covers a wide range of legislations because of historical background. Family procedures will be dealt with by the family courts and the high courts according to their own jurisdiction. It involves a large number of primary legislation, subsidiary legislation, and also practice directions. Now, there are lots of overlapping, and also the legal jargons used are difficult to understand. Significant amount of time and cost is spent on procedural matters, which is not central to the issue. Now, subject to the passage of this bill, family and matrimonial matters will become much more streamlined and harmonized. Unnecessary disputes can be avoided. Now, with the establishment of the FPRC, I hope that the government can invite more professionals, including counselors for young people, as well as social workers, into the committee, so that the family procedures are much more user-friendly and in line with a natural course of natural justice. I support the government's efforts. It will alleviate the unnecessary burden on the judiciary, and more importantly, it contributes to the harmony of society. Now, the Family Procedure Bill will not reduce the number of divorce cases in Hong Kong. However, we can minimize secondary harm inflicted upon divorcees and young people. Now, as an educator, I know that behind every problematic young people, there is a problematic family. And the most problematic thing for a family is divorce. It causes enduring emotional stress to the family as well as financial burden. Now, when I met with the parents of a student, I saw four people, including two fathers and two mothers. Now, that's fine, but the point is, they kept arguing about maintenance payments rather than the future of the child. The child could only watch helplessly the arguments in the family. Now, in 2020, the divorce rate was 58% in Hong Kong. Now, among all the marriages, one third of them are not first-time husband or wife. So it shows that there is a lot of demand for the family procedure system. So the Family Procedure Bill is useful in streamlining the procedures and avoiding secondary harm. Now, we have to ensure that maintenance payments are highly efficient. That is not something that this bill has dealt with, but this is at least a good start. We hope that the government can establish a better enforcement system for maintenance payments. Some members even suggested the establishment of a maintenance board incorporating social workers and youth experts. Now, another thing, maybe the government should consult the public on legislation of co-parenting between divorcees. Now, a harmonious society is built upon harmonious family. Now, we can't reduce divorce rates, but we can reduce the harm done to avoid enduring pain to the child. Thank you. I so submit.
Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I now call upon the Chief Secretary for Administration to reply. Then the debate will come to a close. Chief Secretary, Madam Deputy, first of all, I'm grateful to Mr. Holden Chow, Chairman of the Bills Committee on Family Procedure Bill, other members, as well as the Secretariat for the efforts so that the deliberation of the bill was completed smoothly. I'm also grateful to the members, as well as the members of the public, for their valuable comments tabled in the course of the deliberation. As I pointed out in the second reading of the bill, the purpose of the bill is to implement the proposals of the judiciary in the final report on the review of the family procedure rules to enhance the efficiency and cost effectiveness of the family justice system. A set of comprehensive and accessible procedure rules should be introduced. The bill consolidates provisions and rules scattered across different ordinances, and it also provides a legal basis to introduce a set of family procedure rules. The bill provides for a new Family Procedure Rule Committee as the single authority to make rules for family procedures. The Family Procedure Rule Committee will introduce rules, that is, family procedure rules, covering different areas of family procedures, so as to dispense with the need to make references to different pieces of principal ordinance and subsidiary legislation. In addition, the bill provides for a family master system, so as to empower the registrar and the masters of family court to take up some case management functions. This will alleviate the heavy workload of family judges, and this will enhance the efficiency of the family court. The bill will also propose consequential amendments or repeal certain provisions of 31 pieces of principal legislation and subsidiary legislation to make sure that such provisions, will be compatible with the bill as well as the procedure rules to be introduced later on. The bill is drafted in plain language. In future, when we introduce the FPR, as well as the relevant forms, we continue to use plain language so as to make sure that it is easy to understand. This can cater for the needs of different court users, in particular the unrepresented litigants. Upon passage of the bill by the Legislative Council, it will come into effect in two stages. Some of the provisions will commence immediately. For example, first of all, the provisions concerning the setting up of the Family Procedure Rules Ordinance so that the committee may start the preparation as soon as possible. Second, in relation to the setting up of the Family Masters System so as to ease the burden of the family judges. For the other provisions, including the consequential amendments to other related legislation, they will become effective in the second stage together with the family procedure rules. And the date will be appointed by the CJ of the Court of Final Appeal by a notice in Gazette. The bill, as well as the future FPR, will not result in substantive changes in the policies or the legislation. I'm most grateful to the chairman as well as the members of the Bills Committee. Four meetings were held in 2 months' time. They scrutinized the provisions of the bill in great details so as to make sure that the work will be perfect. I'm glad to see that members are in support of the early passage of the bill so that we can have it commenced as early as possible. President, later on, I'm going to move an amendment so as to remedy a clerical error. And then there will be another amendment in the nature of law adaptation. The technical in nature, the Bills Committee does not object to it. In addition, I'm going to move another amendment which involved the definition of child under Section 2.1 of the Inheritance Provision for Family and Dependence Ordinance, Cap 481. We would like to update a phrase, and then the proposed CSA will delete some of the words originally to be added, so as to allow the common law principle a chance to have further development. The first administration would like to update the old drafting. That is, on the basis of the relevant case law, we like to use clear and easy to understand wording to express the common law principle expressed in the existing wording. That is, the child was in the womb of his or her mother at the death of the deceased and born posthumously. Before he or she would be granted the right to apply for financial provision. This can facilitate easy understanding by the court users without any substantive changes of the policies. But some members are of the opinion that the updated phrase should not have the inclusion of the following words, and born posthumously. And in fact, the meaning should be interpreted by the court, so the common law principles can be given further development under suitable circumstances. Upon consideration by us, we have decided to come up with this amendment, and we have adopted the proposal made by Honorable Lamson Kerr. In addition, I want to briefly respond to points made by members earlier on. Some members were worried that in the course of drafting the FPR, how the judiciary would be taking up the opinions of the court users as well as the stakeholders. For the membership of the committee, other than judges, will include representatives from the legal professional bodies and the Department of Justice. This is very representative, and in fact, they will examine the rules from a professional and operational perspective so as to make sure that when implemented, it will be smooth. In the light of the proposals of the HALSP, the Hong Kong Bar Association and the Hong Kong Law Society will nominate two instead of one representatives to sit on the FPRC. The judiciary has invited the two legal bodies to consider nominating law practitioners with mediation experience so as to better assist the committee in coming up with mediation-related rules. The judiciary has promised that during the drafting of the rules, in due course, the public will be consulted, and there will be an exchange session with the social welfare sector so as to get the views. Before the LegCo is to scrutinize the rules, the judiciary will also carry out an extensive consultation so as to take on board the views of the public. Members were also concerned as to how the judiciary in future would assist the court users, in particular the unrepresented litigants, so that they can better understand and apply the rules. The judiciary is considering a number of support measures, like a one-stop dedicated website so as to deploy an accessible way to highlight the main points in the procedures involved, as well as the forms to be listed out systematically. The judiciary will also set up a family court information corner so that potential litigants will be given the information needed and the assistance needed. Before the rules come into effect, the judiciary will also commence an extensive publicity exercise. Some members are also suggesting that other than introducing the rules, the judiciary should also come up with other measures so as to enhance the service of the family court. In fact, the judiciary has been doing so for a long time. There will be more measures so as to enhance the operational efficiency of the court, like enhancing the hardware of the court, say, for example, new courtrooms with mediation facilities, more flexible deployment of facilities between the family court and other courts, and increasing judicial manpower in due course so as to meet the needs of the operation of the family court. The judiciary will also encourage and promote family procedure mediation. There will be more pilot schemes so that they will be encouraged to use resolution procedure to deal with the disputes. During the course of the deliberation of the bill, some members were concerned about the support given to the needy divorcees as well as issues met during the collection of maintenance payments and the enforcement of the maintenance orders. Currently, the exercise is to provide for the setting up of the rules as well as consolidate the procedures. There's no plan to change the substantive laws or the policies. In fact, the government has come up with improvement measures to help the divorcees to collect the maintenance fees and has stepped up the publicity. The government will consider to review it to see if there's a need to change the collection of payments as well as the enforcement of maintenance orders. The bill will assist in enhancing the efficiency and cost effectiveness of family procedures. I urge members to support the second reading as well as the CSAs. I'm going to move. So I spoke. Thank you.
I now put the question to you that the Family Procedure Bill be read the second time. With those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by a majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed. Family Procedure Bill. This council now becomes committee of the whole council to consider the Family Procedure Bill. Members may refer